Thank you very much, Rosa, for that wonderful introduction. I'm glad you were able to make it. A pleasant good afternoon to all of us. First of all, I'd like to thank all of you for coming here, especially our Vice Chancellor for Academic Affairs, Dr. Rosa, and our colleagues in the galleys, and my students, and all our guests here. Of course, our host, SEARCA. Thank you for arranging this, seminar or presentation for me. Now, as you can see, the title is right here. It's all about a new approach to doing agricultural production. And my objective for this presentation is for you to have an idea, generally, of what it's all about. And specifically, I'll be presenting you some of the principles involved in this particular approach to crop production. Then the advantages and benefits of this particular approach, the evolution, the current state of adoption, the global scale, and in the Southeast Asian region. And then I'll be presenting the advances in experimental research on conservation agriculture, not only in the Philippines, but also in the other Southeast Asian countries. And then I'll present to you some challenges in adoption of this particular technology, and some policy implications, and the prospects of adoption and upscaling in the entire Southeast Asian region. So first of all, what is this all about? What is exactly meant by conservation agriculture? A lot of definitions came out. If you search through the literature, there are so many versions of definitions of conservation agriculture, but I pick out some of them from credible sources. FAO defined it in this way: it's an approach to managing agro-ecosystems for improved and sustained productivity, increased profits and food security, while at the same time preserving and enhancing the resource base and the environment. If you think about it, it's rather vague, but it conforms with our view of sustainable agriculture in the past, that we aim for production, maximum production, and at the same time, environmental protection. But how exactly do we do it? It's not explicit in this definition. Now, UNEP also defined it in this way: it's concept of for resource-saving agricultural production. It strives to achieve acceptable profits together with high and sustained production levels while concurrently conserving the environment. Basically the same as that, but it's more conservative, talking about acceptable profits. But they're basically the same. And still big. So let me show you some other definitions. The Conservation Agriculture Network for Southeast Asia defined it differently. And according to their definition, it's the, or CAs, an agroecological approach associating rural development with environmental preservation, integrating all agricultural practices for viability and sustainability of agriculture as well as environmental protection. Still the same. So nothing too different from the previous definitions. So here's what I like. Well, the definition I like the most is this: the conservation agriculture is any cropping system integrating the three principles of minimum soil disturbance, permanent soil cover, and crop rotations. Why do I like it? Because it tells you how exactly do we achieve that balance between crop production and environmental preservation. So let me put this in perspective in this way. First principle relevant is that there has to be minimum soil disturbance. Therefore, planting has to be done through direct seeding, and no plowing is allowed. You don't have to plowed soil. More tillage. We have to restore the soil only minimally. Second element is that there has to be continuous mulch cover, including cover crops. There has to be a continuous cover of the soil surface with residues along with live cover crops. That's the second one. And thirdly, there has to be crop diversification, diverse crop species rotation. Now, if all those elements are present in the agricultural production system, then we have conservation agriculture. If one of them is absent, we cannot consider that system to be conservation agriculture, strictly speaking. Even if you do minimum tillage, and if you provide mulch cover, if you do monocropping, that is not conservation agriculture. So all these three elements have to be present in the production system for the system to be considered as the conservation agriculture production system. Now, you might say, how minimal is minimal? It's easy to say minimum disturbance. I have here some quantitative figures. You say minimum soil disturbance, you can allow no more than 20 to 25% of soil surface being disturbed. 20 to 25%. Up to 1/4 of the soil surface can be disturbed, but not more than that. If you do it that way, it passes the requirement for conservation agriculture. And therefore, during planting, you have to do direct seeding. For small scale systems, you can do or employ diggers. For medium scale, you can employ job planters like one shown here. And for large systems, you can employ mechanized direct seeders. Okay, so that's how minimum the disturbance of the soil can be or should be under conservation agriculture production systems. Secondly, continuous mulch and residue cover. 30% of the area should be covered by organic matter, residue, and crop cover. And you can see in the middle picture some decaying residues. That's how we do it. And at the same time, during the growing season, we grow cover crops in between the main crops. And these cover crops are usually legumes in nature for their nitrogen fixing capabilities. And well, that's that. There has to be crop residue and cover crops. 30%. Thirdly, diverse crop species rotation. The requirement for conservation agriculture is that there has to be at least 3 different crops to be grown in rotation. Okay? At least 3. And preferably legumes for their nitrogen fixing capability. And for small areas, we can afford to have, or we can do intercropping for areas with limited space. So with this, I hope those three principles are much clearer now, rather than saying minimum soil disturbance, much cover crop rotation. Those are the quantitative requirements for doing conservation agriculture. Now, why do I call it biological engineering? It's actually part of or the expanded version of our traditional agricultural engineering. Now, worldwide, not only in the US, we have expanded our engineering field to include biological engineering. I call it agricultural and biological engineering. And what exactly is biological engineering? Based on the ASAPO definition, it is the discipline of engineering that applies engineering principles and the fundamental concepts of biology to agricultural and biological systems and tools ranging in scale from molecular to ecosystem level for the safe, efficient, and environmentally sensitive production, management of agricultural, biological, food, and natural resources systems. So if you think about this definition, conservation agriculture fits in quite well. although of course the other fields may claim ownership, so to speak, of this particular field. It's open. Biological, biology includes agronomy and all the other associated sciences. It's okay. But the reason why I'm calling it agricultural or biological engineering is that there are other aspects of this particular type of agriculture that requires engineering. But essentially, you see, it requires live entities like cover crops in order to modify the ecosystem for efficient and environmentally safe production endeavors. Now, if you think about what actually happens under conservation agriculture production systems, it's quite complex. Each of the various elements, minimum soil disturbance, continuous mulch cover, and diverse crop rotations, all affect each other or interact with each other, and they influence the biological processes, chemical processes, and physical processes in the soil, lead to the formation of soil organic matter, directly and indirectly, and they all affect the soil structure, which in turn affects the feasibility of doing agriculture, crop production in the area. And it's quite complex, and all of these are interrelated. And ultimately, important ones that they affect soil fertility, availability of water and nutrients, and from the practical standpoint, they affect even suppress weed problems and pest problems. So it's quite complex. So all the biological, chemical, and physical processes are affected by these elements, principles of conservation agriculture. Just imagine a situation where you don't have minimum soil disturbance, or in other words, you till the soil heavily. What will happen? The organic matter present in the soil will be highly exposed to microbial attack. Disturb the soil, the aggregate protecting the soil organic carbon will be exposed to microbial attack. And what will happen? That will lead to reduction of soil organic matter. If you don't have mulch cover, where would your organic carbon come from? So the source will be diminished. And if you don't do diversification, you will have problems with pest infestation, diseases. And that would make the entire crop production endeavor costly. So conversely, if you have this, all those negative or adverse consequences would be avoided. So that's the beauty of this particular book, Conservation Agriculture, from the standpoint of biochemical processes and all those associated processes, even hydrologic processes. Now, what are the advantages of and benefits of this particular technology? I can go on with the listing, but I'd rather give you a listing of benefits that have been proven with science. So, first of all, it's been proven, documented quite well in various literatures, that conservation agriculture increases crop yields. So much empirical evidence that conservation agriculture increases crop yields. It also increases, of course, the soil organic carbon and nutrients. And, I can see here some literature, and I added mine, which was recently published, attesting to the fact that indeed soil organic carbon increases under conservation agriculture. Another benefit is that it improves soil health. The microbial activity, mesofauna, and even fixation are all improved under conservation agriculture. Spent literature attesting to this benefit. It also improves the soil structure, the infiltration characteristics, the water content, and then it reduces erosion and sedimentation. And it also minimizes nutrient leaching. And I'll give you a more detailed description of this particular benefit in a while. And here comes one of the interesting benefits, and that it reduces greenhouse gas emissions. So now it's very big when it comes to combating climate change. And for other biophysical and environmental benefits, improves the management of weeds, insects, diseases, and all other infestations, as attested to by all these researchers in their publications. And from the standpoint of socioeconomic benefits, there's been evidence that it increases the income of the household and the gross margins also. And labor burden is reduced, as well as the production cost, as proven by these researchers. And if you are interested in gender empowerment, there's proof to that, that conservation agriculture empowers women, that women here. So it's good for you. Now let me present to you a little bit of the evolution or history of the conservation agriculture. Where exactly did it start? And how did it start? You know, anything good in this world, especially from the indigenous standpoint, starts with a problem. Back in the 1930s, a big problem was experienced in the US, in the western part of the US. There was this, what they call the dust, great dust bowl. Anyone of you knows what this is all about? At that time, there was a drought that struck the Midwest. And years prior to that drought occurrence, the people there were doing deep tillage. And then here came the drought and the strong winds. So what happened? Wind erosion, a lot of soil disturbances happened. The whole area was rendered unproductive. And they suffered a lot economically at that time. So when the problem happened, they thought about minimum tillage, reduced tillage, no tillage, zero tillage, and covering this area with residues. That's the start of conservation agriculture. It's not yet the true conservation agriculture as I have defined it, but it served as the precursor. So all those technologies that led to the development of all those three elements contributed or serve as precursors to the full-blown conservation agriculture as we know it today. So it started in the 1930s, and a decade later they developed direct seeding machines in the US. And then in the 1960s they commercialized the no-till technology. And what happened afterwards, in the 60s, no-till experiments were performed in Australia, in Europe, and even in Africa. And in the 70s, it was extended to South America and Brazil. And long-term experiments were also done in France. And Brazil and Argentina also in the 70s. And in the 80s, it was introduced in Zimbabwe and the other parts of Europe. In the 90s, it was introduced in Asia, India, Pakistan, and Bangladesh. And it was in the early 90s when China picked it up for Southeast Asia. Southeast Asia, its conservation agriculture was just introduced in the late 90s. And in particular, it was introduced in these countries, Cambodia, Laos, and Vietnam, through French-funded research. So essentially, conservation agriculture in the region is still in its infancy or research stage. And let me show you the current state of adoption of conservation agriculture in the world. In various continents, still the Americas, North and South America, that has the most areas under conservation agriculture, 120 million hectares, more than that. Followed by Australia, then Asia, Europe, and Africa. And these are the top five countries doing conservation agriculture. USA, with 35 million acres. Brazil, close to 32 million acres. Argentina, 29 million acres. Canada, 18. Australia, close to 18 also. And the rest of the world have about 24 million hectares under conservation agriculture, but that does not yet include Southeast Asia. Because if they look at the adoption of CA in Asia, you will see countries outside of Southeast Asia, China, Kazakhstan, India, down to Kyrgyzstan. And if you dig through the website of FAO, you won't find any account for CA adoption in Southeast Asia. It's not in the FAO website. No data with FAO. So I have to dig in for some more literatures in Southeast Asia. Let me show you the total land area for Southeast Asia. We have more than 140 million hectares of land area in Southeast Asia. And it's 400 million. And the total agricultural area is 90 million hectares. It's about 21% of the total land area. What does it mean? Go back to the previous tables. This is a lot. We're talking about conservation agricultural potential for adoption in the region. We have a lot of work to do. It's 90 million hectares of agricultural area that is currently under continuous land degradation because of the traditional way of farming. Now let me show you what I've got. My search of for some literature about the adoption of conservation agriculture in Southeast Asia. In Cambodia, there were reports that some adoption has taken place. But not that much. Think about the hectare rates, talking about hundreds of hectares under conservation agriculture from 2009 to 2014. Not that much. In Laos, they have bigger areas under conservation agriculture. 2008, they have 2,500 hectares under CA. And 3 years later, it was doubled. In other Southeast Asian countries, unfortunately, we don't have data attesting to the, or showing, proving that CA has already been adopted. Now, people would claim, oh, we've been doing oatmeal, reduced meal, as I've said. If we don't have the three elements, it is not considered as conservation agriculture. So, still a long way for us, to go in terms of CA research and adoption. Now, why is this so? If you are a farmer doing conservation, rather conventional theories, and somebody would introduce to you this new concept of agriculture, conservation agriculture, would you shift to it? Would you adapt it? Would you do a sudden shift from theories, plow-based system, to CA? I don't think so. Because farmers are so practical. If they don't see that it's working, they won't take it. Because to cease to believe. And how would you show to them that it's working? You need to provide empirical evidence. There has to be empirical evidence. And for that to happen, there has to be experimental research. So let me show you what we have done so far in the region in terms of research in conservation agriculture. Here's a table. I don't know if you can see it, but let me highlight some of the essential information out of this. The CA research started in mostly in mainland Southeast Asia, continental Southeast Asia. The earliest the country that did it first is Vietnam in the late 90s. It was all foreign funding from various sources, French government, World Bank, French Development Agency, even Australian funding Asia. And then Laos also did it in the early 2000s. After this, early this decade, followed by Cambodia. In both cases, the research were mostly funded by the French government, French Development Agency. It's the counterpart of the USAID in France. But in 2010, we embarked on a joint project with Cambodia, with our Cambodian partners, under the SAMREM. But before that, Thailand also embarked on its own research. And here's what I'm saying, that in our country, in the Philippines, we started working on conservation agriculture research in Mindanao under the USAID funded SAMREM project. So, as you can see, we're still in the research stage. We're still producing empirical evidence to prove to the farmers that this particular technology actually works. There are other short, medium-term research in other countries, Indonesia, even Timor. But that's all we've got. So let me show you some of the particular findings we got. And let me start with the findings I came up with in my research summer project in the Philippines, in Mindanao in particular. Our project started in 2010 and ended in 2014. It's entitled Conservation Agriculture for Food Security in Cambodia and the Philippines. It may sound good, but our argument was that how can food security be possible if the soils are degraded? So here's an approach to doing or conserving the soil resources. The research site is in Claveria, in San Sorrento, in Mindanao. And it's a picture of the research site. It's typical area for most of the crop production areas in the Alpans in Mindanao. You see sloping areas like that, so it's quite representative of what they have in Mindanao. The slope is about 26%, so it's gray, okay? Climate is type 4. Pictures of the site in various years since 2010. And then we dealt with field experiments, 6 treatments, 5 of which are under conservation agriculture production systems. And the 6th one is the control, the cloud based. The first 5 included a main crop and a cover crop. Our main crop included maize, corn, and cassava. The cover crops included Styracanthus guineensis, Arachis quinoa, cowpea, rice wheat. Then the plots were laid out in a randomized complete plot design, litigated 4 times in the area with 2 subplots in terms of fertility level. And these are the pictures of the various plots, the leaflets during that time for doing it. And in case you don't have any idea of what Styracanthus is all about, here's a picture of that particular cover crop, Styracanthus guineensis. Was actually recommended by our partner in Cambodia, who's been an expert in conservation agriculture. When we were designing experiments, we did some brainstorming in Cambodia about what exactly, what cover crops to use, and here's one of the recommendations. The other one is Arachis quinoa. That one. And we did soil quality studies. That's my PhD student doing soil sampling 2 years. And we analyzed the soil quality in terms of soil organic matter, nitrogen, phosphorus, pH, bulk density, etc. And let me just highlight some of the most important findings that we got. That under the cloud-based system, the soil organic carbon is negatively correlated with time, meaning soil organic matter declines continuously. keeps on decreasing. Expense balance is not too high, and even the PBOT is not too low. But the important thing is that we're getting what we were expecting, negative. And maybe with long-term experiments, we can further prove the adverse impact of plow-based systems on soil and carbon. For the best crop systems, we're getting good results. The SOC is increasing under T5, that's cassava with style samples, and T2, that's corn with style samples. So, style samples is a large cover crop, as you see. So, it produces a lot of biomass, and it therefore contributes to the formation of a lot of organic matter in soil. Now, here's the complete listing of the regression analysis of all the SOC versus time for all the treatments. And for most of the top treatments, we're getting positive correlation between SOC and time. If you want to know more about this study, before that, I also did soil moisture monitoring after the various crops using linear measurement and analyze the difference between the soil moisture content under cups and under plowbases. And found out that the soil moisture content under cups is significantly higher than under plowbases. And that is good because the farmer would love to do an early planting after the harvest of the preceding crop. So if you have more moisture remaining in the soil, then you can do early planting. And furthermore, that would have great implication in terms of irrigation frequency. If you want to know more about this, we were able to publish this just last January in the recent Journal of Soil Science. You can actually read it, it's online, it's an open access journal. So just read it for more details. But let me show you some more studies that we did. That's one of my MS students. We did solid transport experiments and modeling to determine how fast the leaching is under conservation agriculture and under plow-based systems. Here's the major finding. The red one is plow-based system in sphere. Blue one is under conservation agriculture production system. After 10 years of continuous implementation of both systems, and we found out through modeling studies that under plow-based systems, there will be higher and faster nutrient leaching. And obviously that's not good for the soils, for the crop production system. While under cup systems, the leaching is slower and lower, not higher. So in terms of economy of fertilizer application, cups or CA is better than plow-based systems. Now, if you want to know more about this, you can just read our publication. It came out in Philippine Agricultural Scientist in 2014. We also did ammonium adsorption studies to further validate whether indeed the leaching is minimal under conservation agriculture or not. So that's ammonium adsorption experiments. We collected samples of soil in selected plots. And we found out that the adsorption capacity under cups is higher, significantly higher than under plow-based systems. So meaning there will be minimal leaching under conservation agriculture production systems than under plow-based. And that corroborates the previous findings of my MS student. Now, aside from soil quality studies, we also did crop yield modeling studies as my other MS student. We collected plant samples, soil samples, to various cropping seasons, and did modeling using the SEARCA model. And here are our major findings: that the crop yield under CA would increase by as much as 10%, I think, under CA. Whereas under plow-based systems, crop yield would be reduced by as much as close to 30% after 10 years of continuous implementation of those systems. Again, if you want to know more of this, you can just read our publication last year in Philippine Agricultural Science. Recently we did further soil quality studies. Last year I was here, almost a year ago, doing a seminar on this particular topic, but more specific focus on soil quality effects of conservation agriculture. And some of you were here at that time, and I told you towards the end that I was expecting a Fulbright visiting scholar to be hosted and to work on this particular project. And she did arrive in August. And we did further collection, data analysis in the same site. This is Nina Halford, the one shown in the picture. And she did a lot of analysis, soil, organic matter, nitrogen, phosphorus, pH, bulk density. But let me just highlight the most important one. I'm zeroing in on soil organic matter because that is the best indicator of soil quality. And in terms of SOC, the soil organic matter is other conservation agriculture production systems, particularly P1 and P2. These are the corn-based systems with two different cover crops, arachis pinctoides for P1 and Stylosanthus for P2. The SOM under those systems, the values were significantly higher than under plow-based. Okay, that's the essence of this, and we're going to publish this. But that's what this done. So now I went back to my original data and incorporated what Serena got and extended the regression analysis. And under plow-based system, here's what I got: that the SOC continue declining. You see that farthest point towards the right is Selena's result. The previous ones were my previous results. And indeed, the SOC continues to decline under cloud-based systems. And that's not good. And more importantly, we're getting not only very high strength variance, but also statistically significant regression slopes. In terms of P-bar, that's way below the level of significance. So indeed, this relationship is valid statistically. Now, under CAPS, not that much, but the good thing is that it's not declining. The SOC is not declining. So which would you prefer? A system with SOC declining or a system with slight increase? If not significant, but just not declining. So that's the essence of these results. Now, other than that, my PhD student, last year I also told you that my PhD student who was here at that time was about to graduate. Well, yes, was able to graduate last year. And he did a lot. He did spatial and temporal analysis of various soil quality parameters. But on top of that, he also, or together under my supervision, we did modeling of organic carbon, long-term prediction of organic carbon, using the ROC model. And based on simulations for so many years until 2050, the x-axis are the various years from 2010 up to the year 2060. The soil organic carbon will indeed increase exponentially under CAPS and decrease in that way the lowest further under CAPS based on modeling studies. But of course, this has to be tested experimentally. Okay, those are the findings we got in the Philippines, but how about in other Southeast Asian countries? Well, there's a dearth of information really, but I was able to find a number of them in various countries. Well, in Cambodia, as part of our summer project, well, that's me, the other one is our Cambodian, or French partner working in Cambodia. When we visited Cambodia in 2011, and their experiment is so extensive. They're doing a lot of, their experimental areas are so vast, so large, and they're working with different main crops, different cover crops, so many different, what they call kitchen experiments. There's so many experiments going on in Cambodia. And one of their recent publications, Lightbox, one of our collaborators in Cambodia, along with the other researchers, we were able to publish last year the results of their work in Cambodia. And the major finding is that the SOC indeed is higher under conservation agriculture compared to conventional activities. Well, other research results, Evelyn, Filipino who worked in North Carolina at State University for his PhD, did experiments in Cambodia. And as part of his dissertation, he was able to prove that SOC, soil and soil water retention and soil recuperation are actually increased by conservation agriculture. And Stefan Bolacke, our partner in Cambodia, French guy, also proved or was able to demonstrate that conservation agriculture increases macrofauna biodiversity. Now, other partners in Cambodia were able to prove that the yield, cassava in particular, will increase and economic returns will increase. So there are some evidences after the benefits of CA already in Cambodia, in Laos. Pascal Leonard, that's also our partner, and Flora Tibet. French guys doing a lot of work on conservation agriculture in Cambodia, in Laos, and even in Vietnam. And they were able to prove the disadvantages again of TH systems. And there will be a lot of, according to their results, the SOC will decrease so much under TH systems. Other results done by other researchers prove that economic returns will increase under CA. In Vietnam, Doan and Tuang and other guys performed experiments on CA, and they were able to show the benefits of conservation agriculture in terms of reduction of soil erosion, crop yield increase, increase in moisture content, increase in soil organic matter, and even the labor cost reduction. In Thailand, some other guys did experiments on conservation agriculture, and they were able to show that the macrofauna density will increase under conservation agriculture, along with biomass. In Indonesia, some researchers also proved the advantages of no-till. It's close enough to conservation agriculture. In terms of soil carbon storage, microbial mass, and earthworm population. Even Timor-Leste, when I was searching for literature, I came across this one. And it came up with this finding that CA would reduce the fuel cost in comparison with plow-based or conservation conventional farming. It's a good proof that can be shown to the farmers. But other than that, I couldn't find any more of this literature on conservation agriculture. So what are the challenges? This poses a big challenge. So the insufficiency of empirical evidences poses a big challenge in terms of adoption. But still, there's a lot of more extensive and long-term research on conservation agriculture in the region. aside from this, we need to have more effective extension services. It's a lot of it still. And policies enabling what's are still lacking. We're talking about promoting and upscaling this particular technology. And of course, the accompanying institutional and financial issues. And the challenges in CA adoption in the region have been summarized by my colleague, one of my co-authors in my recent publication. But if you look at it, it's stable. Agronomic constraints and technological constraints can be addressed through research. Socioeconomic also, but that would require other specialists like socioeconomists, even sociologists, and probably some communication specialists. And then for policy and institutional, we need, of course, that is obviously a challenge in terms of enhancing adoption. So in the region, what are the challenges and the issues and the policy implications that come along with it? This is common knowledge. Everybody knows this, that all these issues and problems beset our, not only the Philippines, but the entire Southeast Asian region. And if you think about what I have just presented, all of this can be addressed through conservation agriculture. It's just a matter of policy reforms and policy, appropriate policy formulations. This is rather self-explanatory. You've seen the benefits of this, and you've seen how conservation agriculture can address soil erosion problems, can address soil degradation problems, can address soil water source problems, even water quality, non-water quality, climate change, climate variability, food security, and poverty alleviation. So what are the prospects for adoption in the region? Fortunately, we have this so-called CANSI, Conservation Agriculture Network for Southeast Asia. It's a network. And it's maybe the key to accelerated adoption of CA in the region. It was established in 2009 with the objective of facilitating information exchange, exchange of experiences among member institutions and countries. But right now it's limited to seven countries: Cambodia, Laos, Vietnam, Thailand, Indonesia, China, and Australia. Yes, there are outsiders, are members of CANSI, China and Australia. You want to take a look at the various institutions involved? Some of these, most of these are research institutions, but one of them is an academic institution from Thailand, University of Kazakhstan. Their involvement is through curricular development. They already developed a curriculum focusing on conservation agriculture to help in the promotion of this particular technology in Thailand. Maybe other countries can follow suit. Now, this CANSI is being coordinated by SEARCA, a French agency. So there's hope, but needs to be expanded to include other countries, like the Philippines. And according to them, it still needs some legal status. It's got to be accredited by ASEAN. But they're working on it. It's a work in progress, as they say. And there's a question of sustainability. Some networks, you know, come and go. I hope this will last for long, until adoption has become widespread. But obviously, there's more work to be done in Southeast Asia to enhance the adoption of conservation agriculture. Particularly, we're talking about sustainable agricultural and rural development. So I think I'm going over time, so let me wind up with this. First of all, conservation agriculture is one of those most promising, again, biological engineering technologies for sustainable agricultural and rural development in Southeast Asia. And the research results on CA field experiments in various countries in Southeast Asia have already provided empirical evidence on the benefits and advantages of this particular technology over the traditional cloud-based system. We already have a lot, but we need some more. And In particular, we have shown the benefits of conservation agriculture in terms of soil quality improvement, crop yield increase, minimization of leaching of nutrients, improvement in soil health, and even the various socioeconomic and environmental benefits over the cloud-based system. And it's got a great potential for addressing climate change, food security, and other agricultural and rural development issues in Southeast Asia. But more work needs to be done, especially long-term research. In other countries, a long time before the farmers took the bite to the challenge of adapting the technology. So what we have done so far are medium-term experiments, we need longer-term experiments. We need proof that this is working locally. But obviously, this will require some financial and institutional support. And the promotion of this particular technology in Southeast Asia can be facilitated through the Conservation Agriculture Network for Southeast Asia. And there's got to be policy reforms and financial and institutional support in order to fully realize the potential of this particular technology for sustainable agricultural and rural development in Southeast Asia. So let me end with this question, which I indirectly already mentioned before. How can we achieve sustained food security and even poverty alleviation and in a country through inclusive economic growth, through agricultural crop production in our region? In view of our these contemporary issues like climate change, if our soils continue to be degraded with our conventional ways of farming, plowing, and the answer, of course, is could be conservation agriculture. In closing, I'd like to acknowledge some people, some of them, of course, for this prestigious award, as attested to by our Vice Chancellor. And my previous project, USAID funded project, my partners in Sanam in Cambodia and the US, and my colleague in FAO, Thailand, colleague in France, these students, my Fulbright Visiting Scholar, and everyone who contributed to the advancement of senior research in Southeast Asia. So, with that, I hope you gain some insight about what conservation agriculture is all about. Again, thank you for coming. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for that very interesting talk. So now we move on to the open forum. Okay. So alam ko po na meron kayong mga questions dyan. So, and I know our speaker will be pleased to answer them. So, sino po ang gustong maunang magtanong? Ah, yes, sir.
Siguro yung senior citizen muna magkatas. I'm Francisco Lapita, a retired research forester from ERDI. I was thinking na, Dr. Elia, pwede pa natin may apply ito doon sa mga areas na under deforestation front ng programa ng gobyerno. Kasi meron tayo SEARCA, kung kailangan natin ng mga legumes, meron mga areas na ang itinatanim ay mga legumes din, no?
Oh yeah, thank you for that question. Yeah, that's possible, highly possible. In fact, we are already doing that with ICRAF. When we embark on the Southern Project, ICRAF, World Agroforestry, we have some partners there in Claveria. They're doing conservation agriculture with trees. Because previously in our Southern Project, we just dealt with purely agroforestry without conservation agriculture. So it's like a marriage of the previous Southern Project and the new one. So it became conservation agriculture with trees. And I believe it's still going on in Claveria. And as to your question, it is highly suitable to areas under reforestation because those areas must have already been degraded. And conservation agriculture actually improves the soil quality. It's one of the best ways to restore the land areas that have been degraded. And therefore, yes, it's feasible, suitable, and highly recommended.
May I suggest then that you contact the DNR? Because DNR is giving financial assistance to projects similar to this one.
Thank you for that tip. When I mentioned policy reforms
and financial support.
And financial support. Thanks for that information.
Okay, sir. Yes, ma'am. Wait. How would you situate organic agriculture in conservation agriculture? Kasi currently we have a law on organic agriculture. There's already that policy on organic agriculture. So how has our experience in organic agriculture going to affect what you're actually proposing or recommending with regards to conservation agriculture?
Organic farming based on FAO accounts can be combined with conservation agriculture. So there's no problem marrying the two, organic farming and conservation agriculture. But if you are doing research on conservation agriculture, in the early years you have to rely on synthetic fertilizer first. That's a must, because otherwise the crops won't survive. But once the system has stabilized, you can introduce organic agriculture. So I think we just have to be patient, so to speak, and introduce the merits of the two in due time. But it's possible to combine organic agriculture with conservation agriculture.
Thank you, sir. Other questions? Yes, sir, Roger.
First of all, congratulations, sir, for the Secretary Chair. You mentioned one problem regarding institutional and financial aspects. So last year, we submitted to the UNCCD a national action plan for combat desertification, land degradation, and drought. Actually, I am the UPLB representative to the BSWF Subcommittee on Water. So, but I am on the water side, so I didn't very much dealt with the soil conservation aspects. But now we are I think the BSWM and some other government agencies are now proposing to have this national action plan implemented. So I think they'll be proposing some budgets and I don't know, some other research funds for this, and so I think we might be able to, on my part, being a member of that subcommittee, can we invite you to maybe present this so we can actually be to spearhead some other projects regarding conservation agriculture in line with this national action plan, which is national action plan 2015 to 2025. So it is a 10-year plan, so we will be implementing hopefully this year.
Yeah, thank you for that information. Yes, I'm willing to do the presentation to them to hopefully get this included in the action plan. Because we believe those who have been involved in conservation agriculture research believe that this is really the key to address so many of the contemporary issues: climate change, climate variability, water security, food security. This one. And therefore, this has to be included in any action plan. Not only in the Philippines, but in the other countries of Southeast Asia as well. Because this has already been done in other parts of the world. And I think it's about time that we do the same. So thank you for that, and just let me know when that will be, and I'll be there.
Okay. Other questions? Meron pa po ba? Ay, sir. Yes, sir.
Thank you, Doctor, for that very interesting discussion. I am a provincial Mauricio, a retired faculty member of the College of Forest and Natural Sources, and a researcher of UPLB. Well, may I make a suggestion?
Sure.
That there should be this working partnership between educational institutions like colleges and the research agencies of the government and research groups in private research groups, because if these three groups work together, I believe they can do better than if kanya-kanya system. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for that wonderful suggestion. In fact, one of the requirements of CANSI, the Conservation Agriculture Network for Southeast Asia, for a country to be a member, that country should first have its own network in that particular country. So right now, we are working on the Philippine the PICAN network, Philippine Conservation Agriculture Network, together with institutions from Mindanao and like ICRAF, MOSCAP, even PSWN. But still a work in progress. We started working on that when we had a convenient PBB in summer in 2014. But a lot of things happened along the way and we're still putting things together. But yes, we will include your suggestion to include also the private research institutions. Because we believe, you're right, I agree with what you said, that it's in working together, including everybody involved, that we can achieve more results. So we will factor that in our next meetings. And as I've said, we need policy reforms, and what Dr. Luis said, I think is a good way to towards that end. Thank you.